Elsa reads A Game of Thrones by George Martin. Chapter 5. John. There were times, not many but a few, when John Snow was glad he was a bastard. As he filled his wine cup once more from a passing flagon, it struck him that this might be one of them. He settled back in his place on the bench among the younger squires and drank. The sweet, fruity taste of summer wine filled his mouth and brought a smile to his lips. The great hall of Winterfell was hazy with smoke and heavy with the smell of roasted meat and fresh baked bread. Its grey stone walls were draped with banners. White, gold, crimson, the direwolf of Stark, Baratheon's Cronstag, the line of Lannister. A singer was playing the high harp and reciting a ballad, but down at this end of the hall his voice could scarcely be heard above the roar of the fire, the clang of pewter plates and cups, and the low mutter of 100 drunken conversations. It was the fourth hour of the welcoming feast laid for the king. John's brothers and sisters had been seated with the royal children beneath the raised platform where Lord and Lady Stark hosted the king and queen. In honour of the occasion, his lord father would doubtless permit each child a glass of wine, but no more than that. Down here on the benches, there was no one to stop John drinking as much as he had a thirst for. And he was finding that he had a man's thirst, to the raucous delight of the youths around him, who urged him on every time he drained a glass. They were fine company, and John relished the stories they were telling, tales of battle and betting and the hunt. He was certain that his companions were more entertaining than the king's offspring. He had sated his curiosity about the visitors when they made their entrance. The procession had passed not a foot from the place he had been given on the bench, and John had gotten a good long look at them all. His lord father had come first, escorting the queen. She was as beautiful as men said. A jeweled tiara gleamed amidst her long golden hair, its emeralds a perfect match for the green of her eyes. His father helped her up the steps of the dais and led her to her seat, but the queen never so much as looked at him. Even at 14, John could see through her smile. Next had come King Robert himself, with Lady Stark on his arm. The king was a great disappointment to John. His father had talked of him often. The peerless Robert Baratheon, demon of the Trident, the first usurier of the realm, a giant amongst princes. John saw only a fat man, red face under his beard, sweating through his silks. He walked like a man half in his cups. After them came the children, little Rickon first, managing the long walk with all the dignity a three-year-old could muster. John had to urge him on when he stopped to visit. Close behind came Rob, in grey wool trimmed with white the Stark collars. He had the Princess Marcella on his arm. She was a whips of a girl, not quite 8, her hair a cascade of golden curls under a jewelled net. John noticed the shy look she gave Rob as they passed between the tables and the timid way she smiled at him. He decided she was insip. Rob didn't even have the sense to realize how stupid she was. He was grinning like a fool. His half-sisters escorted the royal princess. Ira was paired with plump young Tommen, whose white blonde hair was longer than hers. Sansa, 2 years older, drew the crown prince, Geoffrey Baratheon. He was 12, younger than Jobb or Rob, but taller than either, to John's vast dismay. Prince Geoffrey that had his sister's hair and his mother's deep green eyes. A thick tangle of blonde curls dripped down past his golden choker and high velvet collar. Sansa looked radiant as she walked beside him, but John did not like Geoffrey's pouty lips or the bored, disdainful way he looked at Winterfell's great hall. He was more interested in the pair that came behind him, the Queen's brothers, the Lannisters of Castle Rock, the Lion and the Imp. There was no mistaking which was which. Sir Jaime Lannister was twin to Queen Cersei, tall and golden, with flashing green eyes and a smile that cut like a knife. He wore crimson silk, high black boots, a black satin cloak. On the breast of his tunic, the lion of his house was embroidered in gold thread, roaring his defiance. They called him the Lion of Lannister to his face and whispered Kingslayer behind his back. John found it hard to look away from him. This is what a king should look like, he thought to himself as the man passed. Then he saw the other one, waddling along half hidden by his brother's side, Tyrion Lannister, the youngest of Lord Tywin's brood and by far the ugliest. All that the gods had given to Cersei and Jaime they denied Tyrion. He was a dwarf, half his brother's height, struggling to keep pace in stunted legs. His head was too large for his body, with the brute squashed in face beneath a swollen shelf of brow. One green eye and one black one peered out from under a lank fall of hair, so blonde it seemed white. John watched him with fascination. The last of the High Lords to enter were his uncle, Benjen Stark of the Night's Watch, and his father Swart, young Theon Greyjoy. Benjen gave John a warm smile as he went by. Theon ignored him utterly, but there was nothing new in that. After all had been seated, toasts were made, thanks were given and returned, and then the feasting began. John had started drinking then, and he had not stopped. Something rubbed against his leg beneath the table. John saw red eyes staring up at him. "Hungry again?" he asked. There was still half a honey chicken in the center of the table. John reached out to tear off a leg, then had a better idea. He knifed the bird whole and let the carcass slide to the floor between his legs. Ghost ripped it into a savage silence. His brothers and sisters had not been permitted to bring their wolves to the banquet, but there were more curses than John could count at this end of the hall, and no one had said a word about his pup. He told himself he was fortunate in that too. His eyes stung. John rubbed at them savagely, cursing the smoke. He swallowed another gulp of wine and watched his dire wolf devour the chicken. Dogs moved between the tables, trailing after the serving girls. One of them, a black mongrel bitch with long yellow eyes, caught the scent of the chicken. She stopped and edged under the bed to get a share. John watched the confrontation. The bitch growled low in her throat and moved closer. Ghost looked up, silent, and fixed the dog with those red eyes. The bitch snapped an angry challenge. She was three times the size of the direwolf pup. Ghost didn't move. He stood over his prize and opened his mouth, baring his fangs. The bitch tensed, barked again, then thought better of this fight. She turned and slunk away with one less defiant snap to save her pride. Ghost went back to his meal. John grinned and reached under the table to ruffle the shaggy white fur. The direwolf looked up at him, nipped gently at his hand, and went back to eating. "Is this one of the direwolves I've heard so much of?" a familiar voice asked close at hand. John looked up happily as his uncle Ben put a hand on his head and ruffled his hair much as John had ruffled the wolves. "Yes," he said. "His name is Ghost." One of the squires interrupted the bawdy story he'd been telling to make room at the table for their lord's brother. Benjen Stark straddled the bench with long legs and took the wine cup out of John's hand. "Summer wine," he said after a taste. "Nothing so sweet. How many cups have you had, John?" John smiled. Ben Stark laughed. "As I feared. Oh, well, I believe I was younger than you the first time I got truly and sincerely drunk." He snagged a roasted onion, dripping brown with gravy from a nearby trench, and bit into it. It crunched. His uncle was sharp-featured and gaunt as a mountain crag, but there was always a hint of laughter in his blue-gray eyes. He dressed in black, as befitted a man of the Night's Watch. Tonight it was rich black velvet, with high leather boots and a white belt with a silver buckle. A heavy silver chain was looped round his neck. Benjen watched Ghost with amusement as he ate his onion. "A very quiet wolf," he observed. "He's not like the others," John said. "He never makes a sound. That's why I named him Ghost. That, and because he's white. The others are all dark, grey or black. There are still dire wolves beyond the wall. We hear them on our rangings." Benjen Stark gave John a long look. "Don't you usually eat at a table with your brothers?" "Most times," John answered in a flat voice. "But tonight Lady Stark thought it might give insult to the royal family to see their bastard among them." "I see." His uncle glanced over his shoulder at the raised table at the far end of the hall. "My brother doesn't seem very festive tonight." John had noticed that too. A bastard had to learn to notice things, to read the truth of people hid behind their eyes. His father was observing all the courtesies, but there was tightness in him that John had seldom seen before. He said little, looking out over the hall with hidden eyes, seeing nothing. Two seats away, the king had been drinking heavily all night. His broad face was flushed behind his great black beard. He made many a toast, laughed loudly at every jest, and attacked each dish like a starving man, but beside him the queen seemed as cold as an ice sculpture. "The queen is angry too," John told his uncle in a low, quiet voice. "Father took the king down to the crypts this afternoon. The queen didn't want him to go." Benjen gave John a careful measuring look. "You don't miss much, do you, John? We could use a man like you on the wall." John swelled with pride. "Rob is a stronger lance than I am, but I'm the better sword. And Holland says I sit a horse as well as anyone in the castle. Notable achievements." Take me with you when you go back to the war, John said in a sudden rush. Father will give me leave to go if you ask him. I know he will. Uncle Benjamin studied his face carefully. The war is a hard place for a boy, John. I'm almost a man grown, John protested. I will turn 15 on my next name day, and Master Lewin says bastards grow up faster than other children. That's true enough, Benjamin said with a downward twist of his mouth. He took John's cup from the table, filled it fresh from a nearby pitcher, and drank down a long swallow. Daeron Targaryen was only 14 when he conquered Dorne, John said. The young dragon was one of his heroes. A conquest that lasted a summer, his uncle pointed out. Your boy king lost 10,000 men taking the place and another 50 trying to hold it. Someone should have told him that war was in a game. He took another sip of wine. Also, he said, wiping his mouth, Daeron Targaryen was only 18 when he died. Have you forgotten that part? I forget nothing, John boasted. The wine was making him bold. He tried to sit very straight to make himself seem taller. I want to serve in the Night's Watch, uncle. He had thought on it long and hard, lying abed at night while his brother slept around him. Rod would someday inherit Winterfell, would command great armies as the Warden of the North. Bran and Rickon would be Rob's bannerman and rule Hallfast in his name. His sisters Arya and Sansa would marry the heirs of other great houses and go south as mistress of castles of their own. But what place could a bastard hope to earn? You don't know what you're asking, John. The Night's Watch is a sworn brotherhood. We have no families. None of us will ever father sons. Our wife is duty. Our mistress is honor. A bastard can have honor too, John said. I'm ready to swear your oath. You're a boy of 14, Benjen said. Not a man, not yet. Until you have known a woman, you cannot understand what you would be given up. I don't care about that, John said hotly. You might if you knew what it meant, Benjen said. If you knew what the oath could cost you, you might be less eager to pay the price, son. John felt anger rise inside him. I am not your son. Benjen stuck it up, most of the pity. He put a hand on John's shoulder. Come back to me after your father has a few bastards of your own and we'll see how you feel. John trembled. I will never father a bastard, he said carefully. Never! He spat it out like venom. Suddenly he realized the table had fallen silent, they were all looking at him. He felt the tears begin to well behind his eyes. He pushed himself to his feet. I must be excused, he said, with the last of his dignity. He whirled and bolted before they could see him cry. He must have drunk more wine than he had realized. His feet got tangled under him as he tried to leave, and he lurched sideways into a serving girl and sent a flagon of spiced wine crashing to the floor. Laughter boomed all around him, and John felt hot tears in his cheeks. Someone tried to steady him. He wrenched free of the grip and ran half-blind for the door. Ghost followed close at his heels, out into the night. The yard was quiet and empty. A lone sentry stood high on the battlements on the inner wall, his cloak pulled tight around him against the cold. He looked bored and miserable as he huddled there alone, but John would have traded places with him in an instant. Otherwise the castle was dark and deserted. John had seen an abandoned Holdfast once, a drear place where nothing moved but the wind and the stones kept silent about whatever people had lived there. Winterfell reminded him of that tonight. The sounds of music and song spilled through the open windows behind him. They were the last things John wanted to hear. He wiped away his tears in the sleeve of his shirt, furious that he had let them fall, and turned to go. Boy! A voice called out to him. John turned. Tyrion Lannister was sitting on the ledge above the door to the Great Hall, looking for all the world like a gargoyle. The dwarf grinned down at him. Is that animal a wolf? A direwolf, John said. His name is Ghost. He stared up at the little man, his disappointment suddenly forgotten. What are you doing up there? Why aren't you at the feast? Too hot to noise and I drink too much wine, the dwarf told him. I learned long ago that it is considered rude to vomit on your brother. Might I have a closer look at your wolf? John hesitated, then nodded slowly. Can he climb down or shall I bring you a ladder? Oh, bleed that, the little man said. He pushed himself off the ledge into empty air. John gasped, then watched with awe as Tyrion Lannister spun around in a tight ball, landed lightly on his hands and vaulted backward onto his legs. Ghost backed away from him uncertainly. The dwarf dusted himself off and laughed. I believe I frightened your wolf. My apologies. He's not scared, John said. He knelt and called out, Ghost, come here, come on, that's it. The wolf pup paddled closer and nuzzled at John's face, but he kept a wary eye on Tyrion Lannister. When the dwarf reached out to pat him, he drew back and bared his fangs in a silent snare. Shy, isn't he? Lannister observed. Sit, Ghost, John commanded. That's it. Keep still. He looked up at the dwarf. You can touch him now. He won't move until I tell him to. I've been training him. I see, Lannister said. He ruffled the snow-white fur between Ghost's ear and said, Nice wolf. If I wasn't here, he'd tear out your throat, John said. It wasn't actually true yet, but it would be. In that case, you had best stay close, the dwarf said. He cocked his oversized head to one side and looked John over with his mismatched eyes. I'm Tyrion Lannister. I know, John said. He rose. Standing, he was taller than the dwarf. It made him feel strange. You're Ned Stark's bastard, aren't you? John felt a coldness pass right through him. He pressed his lips together and said nothing. Did I offend you? Lannister said. Sorry. Dwarfs don't have to be tactful. Generations of capering fools and motley have won me the right to dress badly and say any damn thing that comes into my head, he grinned. You are the bastard, though. But Eddard Stark is my father, John admitted stiffly. Lannister studied his face. Yes, he said. I can see it. You have more of the North in you than your brothers. Half-brothers, John corrected. He was pleased by the dwarf's comment, but he tried not to let it show. Let me give you some counsel, bastard, Lannister said. Never forget who you are, for surely the world will not. Make it your strength, then it can never be your weakness. Armor yourself in it, and it will never be used to hurt you. John was in no mood for anyone's counsel. What do you know about being a bastard? All dwarves are bastards in the father's eyes. You're your mother's true one, son of Lannister. Am I? The wolf replied, sardonic. Do tell my lord father. My mother died birthing me, and he's never been sure. I don't even know who my mother was, John said.